right, well, let's get started. Thanks for joining today's Ignite webcast. My name is Josh Topal, and I'm a program manager for Office 365. And Ignite events are a series of technical workshops for IT professionals and Microsoft partners. And these Ignite webcasts will address different technical subjects and scenarios that are really beneficial to anyone that wants to increase their knowledge of the Office 365 suite. So today we're really lucky to have Roop Sankar leading our webcast. Roop is a premier field engineer for Microsoft in the UK and has close to 8 years of IT experience. So in today's webcast, Roop will be diving into data loss prevention in Exchange 2013. So today's session, again, just provides a really good opportunity to hear directly from someone that works so closely with Office 365. And today's webcast will be about an hour, and we're going to leave a few minutes at the end to field questions from anyone on the call. So if you could hold on to those questions until the end and then go ahead and type them, I'll let you know at the end of the presentation when you can go ahead and type those in. And one last thing is that we are recording today's session. So we will have today's webcast recording and the presentation that you're about to see on the original blog post, which I'm going to paste in right now. But that's it for me. So, Roop, whenever you're ready, take it away.
Thank you, Josh. So I see people from different parts of the world joining in. So good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to you all. And today's session, though it's titled Exchange 2013, it applies to both on-prem and to Office 365. So if you're a new tenant on Office 365, you should be able to use the data loss prevention features, or else if you're an existing customer of Office 365, you should be probably being migrated or in the process of being migrated, and then you should be able to use this. Anyway, I'll be talking about in detail with a few demos showing you both the admin side and the you know, the end user side of using DLP in all. So before we actually go into or talking into DLP, I just wanted to bring the slide because this would lay forth the whole presentation. You know, what exactly is DLP? You know, for those who are not aware, or for those who don't have a deep understanding of what it is. So this is what, you know, in our IT career, we might have at least read a headline, something similar to this, or might have been unfortunately a part of an organization which had to go through this the situation. So DLP is a feature or a functionality within Exchange 2013 which would prevent such situations. So in short, the definition would be DLP would help you to identify, monitor, protect sensitive data through deep content analysis. So I would like to highlight the last piece, which is the deep content analysis, because it is very unlike any product that is there wherein it will just kind of look at few parameters and then make a decision like as in yes or no. It actually does a very, very, it goes through in depth and sees exactly what the content is. Is it sensitive? Is it not sensitive? Could it be sensitive? Or and then it kind of builds upon that. Just like any technology or any feature that is implemented, within an organization, even with DLP, when the product group was trying to build or think about DLP, it has its own challenges. And then the challenges can be broken down into, you know, various categories or very broad sectors. And it was broken down into three different personas. The first one is the administrator, the other one is the information worker, and the third is the compliance officer. So let's just look at each one as we go. The first is the administrator. The administrator needs to know how much sensitive data is there within the organization and how much of that sensitive data is actually going across, that's going out to other organizations or going out to the internet, and how much information, sensitive information, is coming in. Once he knows about that, then he needs to set up controls. And once he sets up controls, he needs to make sure that it's not affecting day-to-day business. You know, it should not hinder anything that's already been ongoing. The second persona, which is the most important within any organization, is the information worker. So the information worker is a person who is doing his day-to-day job. And when you introduce a process, it should not affect his productivity. And if you were to ever, you know, put in a process which is very complicated or which is very convoluted, you would always tend to see that the end users would find a way around it or they would stop using it. So the introduction of the system would be just a failure right at the get-go. And the last is the compliance officer. The compliance officer, when you're implementing a system like DLP, needs to have the peace of mind that when he implements DLP, everything is getting, you know, everything is working as expected. You know, things are getting blocked, things are getting redirected. You know, it's working as he was expecting, rather than thinking that, okay, is there something that can slip past? So these are the three things that were kept in mind when the product group was actually building DLP, and they've actually addressed each one of those, and I'll show it in a demo, and which I feel is very, very good overall. It is very important to know or note for the exchange admin or for the business that DLP is actually designed to prevent accidental disclosure of sensitive data. So I highlight the word accidental over there, because the majority of the times the data that's kind of that slips out of the organization is accidental, because there are so many policies every organization has, and it's not easy for every end user to remember what each policy is. And even if there's a policy, it keeps changing, so it's very hard for the end user to actually remember. So whenever there is any data loss, it's mostly, or majority of the times, it's always accidental. However, you also have to keep in mind that DLP is not a 100% solution, like an unbreakable solution. Obviously, if there is a user who's intent on, or, you know, pulling out data and then, you know, giving it to somebody else, you cannot stop him, because he can just open up, let's say, an Excel sheet with all your client contacts, and he can just take a picture. So obviously, you could not stop that kind of a situation. So DLP is actually addressing situations where there is accidental disclosure of any sensitive data, any accidental leaks, because of the end user not remembering or not being aware of all the policies that are there within the organization. So till now we have talked about, you know, the definition of DLP, the challenges, and, you know, what DLP is actually designed for. Let's go ahead and actually understand what is the data that we can actually look or filter in DLP. So technically, DLP can actually filter on any content. And I again highlight the fact it can actually filter any content. Out of the box, though, there are pre-canned file types and extensions that it can go ahead and filter upon. However, let's say in your organization you have a custom application that spits out a file type, a custom file type of .abc. DLP out of the box wouldn't understand what to do with it. So what you will have to do is you will have to create a new classification. And if you go on MSDN, there are resources telling you how to create that. Or else, if it is a little bit complicated, you can actually go ahead to third-party vendors and sit with them and tell them that I have this custom application which creates this custom file type. Could you help me write this custom classification? And then you can import that classification into DLP. And once that is imported, then your DLP, you know, the DLP system as such, would start filtering upon that content. Out of the box, as I just mentioned a slide earlier, out of the box, these are the file types and extensions that DLP can actually filter upon. And you can see these are your day-to-day file types that an end user would use, you know, while he's communicating with somebody else. You've got all your document types, you've got your Excel, PowerPoint, text, you've got all your archives, like as in your RARs and your zip files, RTF, HTML and XML and PDF. So as you can see, out of the box, these are all by default. By default, DLP can just start scanning them or looking into them and then performing the appropriate action. Okay. And as mentioned earlier, any custom, go ahead, create your own custom classifications, or else so you can sit down with a third-party vendor and have them build it for you. Let us now look at DLP from an Exchange admin's perspective. And before I actually go into that, I just thought I would bring up all the laws and acts and, you know, regulations that organizations have to comply with regards to sensitive data. And they are, you know, they vary depending on the geographical location you are at, and they also vary depending on the type of sector you belong to. So for those who are connected, you know, who are joining in from the U.S., you probably know the Patriot Act, you know, the serve from the bottom. You know, those of you who are from the European Union, you know, the European Union Data Protection Directive. And if you're in a financial or a health sector, for example, you have to abide by the HIPAA, Act. So these are all the different types of acts that different companies, depending on your location and depending on your sector, you need to abide by, or at least, you know, try and abide by if you don't want any kind of a legal situation. Now, if I come to the Exchange admin and I say, okay, here is, let's take the first one, the SOX, the SOX, we say the business says we tell the exchange admin we need to implement this. The exchange admin then goes to the compliance officer. The compliance officer gives him a big fat document telling him these are the things that the SOX Act tells you to abide by. Now the exchange admin has to first find out what is the sensitive data, and then he needs to set in controls, which for an exchange admin is not his kind of, you know, a cup of tea, as you call it. So what we've done in Exchange 2013 with regards to DLP for the exchange admin is create pre-canned templates. And these templates are aligned to every act and policy that's available, you know, across the world. And the list that I showed you earlier was just a small snapshot. There are lots, actually, but those are the ones that I've seen being used a lot. So that's why I just pulled that up. So if you open up the console, which I'll show it to you in the demo as well, if you open up the Exchange Admin Center, and you go into the DLP section, you've got these whole list of policies that are already there. So you as an admin, all you have to do is just pick one which is more relevant to your organization or to your geographical location, pick that up, and then go ahead and then tweak it. You know, you can tune it, you can detune it, you can just, you know, scrub it, you know, do whatever you like. It's very, very flexible and very open. And all these templates are nothing but an XML blob. You know, it's just an XML file which contains all the types of action, and then within the action, what are the type of data that it needs to look for. So let us say you're only interested in credit card numbers. So that template would just create credit card numbers. If it's a social security number, then it'll, you know, you're defining. So this template or those policies are nothing but XML files that contain all the schema, not the AD schema, but the schema as in the syntax of what needs to be scanned, and if it finds something sensitive, what action it needs to perform on it, et cetera, et cetera. So this is already comes pre-canned, and there's a whole big list, and I'll show it to you. That's there, and it's always evolving. But there is no proper cycle as of now, but as and when the product group finds new templates that it needs to push out, it will push it out to the exchange admin or to the on-prem environment. Now, I was about to show the demo right now, but what I thought is, because you're all exchange admins, it is always nice, you know, rather than just knowing, okay, DLP does this, you know, DLP, you can turn it on like this, and then, you know, it starts functioning, you know, just like the way it should. I thought, okay, let me just talk about the architecture, because it's very important as an exchange admin to understand what DLP or where DLP sits. Because it's a new feature, it can be a little surprising to know where exactly DLP sits at within the whole exchange architectural stack. Does it sit within the store? Is it within IIS? Is it within exchange web services? You know, where exactly is DLP? You know, I know how to configure it, but where exactly is it? So that is why I thought I'll just pull up a few slides just talking about the architecture of DLP so that it becomes more clear for you. So in the future, it helps you with troubleshooting. It will probably help you with, you know, fine-tuning it. It can help you with other aspects of DLP itself. So the architecture area of DLP is broken down into two very broad segments. And the two segments are the exchange transport architecture, which is the server-side component. And the second segment is the Outlook architecture, which is the client side of it. So we've got two different, you know, aspects to the whole architecture, the whole DLP architecture. So both work hand in hand. So you've got the Exchange Transport architecture, which is server side. You've got the Outlook architecture, which is the client side. So let's talk about the first one, which is the Exchange Transport architecture. The Exchange Transport architecture is made up of three components, which are engines or agents, however you want to call them. And these are the three components. So you've got the text extraction agent, you've got the classification engine, and lastly, you've got the policy engine. So let's understand what each of that agent or engine does. The first one, I think, is very self-explanatory as to what it does. The text extraction agent does nothing but extracts all the text from the body of the email and anything from the attachment. So if you have like a PDF document, or if you have an Excel document with lots of, you know, credit card numbers or social security numbers, the text extraction agent is just pulling out all the data out. That is all it does, nothing else. Once the text is extracted, this text is then fed to the classification engine. And the classification engine is where all the deep content analysis takes place. So this is where the engine is trying to look for whether whether the email contains any credit card numbers, whether it contains some bank numbers, sort code numbers, driver's license numbers, social security numbers, any type of sensitive data. So this is where the classification engine is actually running, parsing through the whole text, the text that was extracted, and then, identifying what those sensitive data are, and then stacking it into different areas, credit card numbers, then social security numbers, bank, sort codes, whatnot, anything that's sensitive. Once the classification engine identifies all that, it sends that information, whatever it has identified, it sends it to the next component, which is called the, It's called the policy engine. And the policy engine is the brains of the whole operation. And this is where the action takes place. So let us say the classification engine has identified credit card numbers. So it tells, okay, I found 5 credit card numbers. Then the policy engine kicks in and then it says, okay, 5 credit card numbers, the business says, or, the admin has defined that if you have credit card numbers, either I will, blindly drop the email, or I will NDR the email with a custom text saying that, okay, you are against policy, or I would forward it to the sender's manager wherein he can approve that that email. So these are the three different components that function hand in hand or are how DLP is built on. So DLP is these three components. And they all three work in sync so that a particular action is taken accordingly. So now I've talked about the three components, but I still didn't tell you where exactly is DLP sitting. It's a dead giveaway if you just look at the title of the slide. It's Exchange Transport Architecture. So where does DLP sit? The server side, it sits within the transport pipeline. And on the left, you can see that the blue stack of boxes, that's your transport pipeline. And the DLP sits within the categorizer, and it's integrated into ETR. ETR stands for the Exchange Transport Rule Agent, or you can even call it the Exchange Transport Rule Engine. And when a mail comes in, when it hits the categorizer, it hits the Transport Rule Agent, and that's where the three components are called. So you have the text extraction, which then sends all that information to the classification engine, and then the classification engine sends it to the policy. Since this is all sitting within the transport pipeline, it is very flexible. You can use existing transport predicates or actions. So if you have opened up a transport rule, it comprises of, you've got your condition, you've got your action, and you've got your, exceptions. So because this is the DLP rule itself is a part of the transport pipeline, you can actually integrate it with other existing predicates and actions, your transport rules or your different types of actions, your different types of exceptions, et cetera, et cetera. And I'll show it to you in a demo, what it looks like. So if you look at a DLP rule for the first time, it would just look like a transport rule. But it is more intelligent because it does more things than just doing a basic transport rule functionality as in just forwarding an email or dropping an email or adding a header. It does more things than that. So DLP, if you want to know what a DLP is, I would say in a very simple term, it is a very, very smart transport rule. Okay, and I've got a few examples which hopefully would clarify or distinguish it from a transport rule, from a basic transport rule to a very complex DLP rule. And this one is just to put everything into perspective, and this is not a proper workflow, it is a logical workflow. So let's say a mail comes in, from the left you can see the mail coming in, it hits the transport rules agent, which is sitting within your categorizer, and then, the three components are called your policy engine, your text extraction agent, and your classification agent. So the text extraction pulls out that information, gives it to the classification agent, the classification agent then gives it to the policy engine then takes appropriate action, NDR it, drop it, forward it, or whatnot. So any type of action. And there are a whole raft of actions. I'm just giving a few examples. To make all of this very clear, to understand, how these components are called and how it is special as compared to your normal transport rules, I've just put up this example over here. In this example, what I'm doing is I'm sending an email to a travel agent, Acme Travel, and I want to do a hotel reservation or some reservation. So I send my name, my card type, which is Visa. I've sent my credit card number and the expiry date, because these are the requirements if you want to do any kind of a booking. So let us see how Exchange 2013, the DLP policies, how do they actually go about processing this particular email? So the first step, as we know, is it's going to extract the text extraction agent is going to pull out the text. So it's going to pull out everything, but, you know, just to keep it simple on the screen, I've just pulled out the relevant data. So here's the name, then it pulls out the card type, the card number, and the expiry date. So this is the first step. It's just extracted the text from the particular email. And when I'm saying email, it's also the attachment. So it's not only the body of the email. So if I had an attachment within this email, it would extract even everything, you know, within that attachment as well. The second step is a very basic regular expression analysis. So regex is a regular expression. And what it's just trying to see is, does this mail contain a 16-digit number? Eight-digit number, or a five-digit number, a social security number. I'm not sure how long how many numbers it contains, but let's say it's five. So it's just looking for a five-digit number, a 16-digit number, or an 18-digit number. It's just doing a basic, regular expression analysis. Nothing fancy, nothing funky over there. Okay? So that is all it's looking for. And if you just go a step back in time, and if you think about Exchange 2007 and Exchange 2010, both Exchange 2007 and Exchange 2010 had this ability of creating a transport rule, where you could create a regular expression looking for 16-digit numbers. But if you were to implement something of a DLP in Exchange 2007 and 2010, it wouldn't be very effective, because what you're doing is just looking for a 16-digit number. You're not kind of doing some intelligence around it to make sure whether that 16-digit number is a credit card number or it is just a 16-digit number. So in Exchange 2013, we go a few steps further, and we do a little bit of intelligence and a little bit of, you know, an evidence gathering, and only then we kind of say, yes, this is a credit card number. So let's come back to Exchange 2013, and let's see what's the next step. The second step is functional analysis. So what we do is we run that number. So we say, okay, 16-digit number, fine, but we need to still prove whether the 16-digit number is a credit card number. So we run that number, we generate a checksum for that number, and every credit card number or debit card number has an internationally unique checksum on it. So we match the checksum to that unique checksum and then see whether it is a credit card number. And in that example, number two, you know, in stage three, number two, you see another number, 1234, 1234 repeated, So that is another 16-digit number, but when Exchange or the DLP generates a checksum for that number, it doesn't match any known unique checksums for a credit card or a debit card number. So it just denies it because it says, I see a 16-digit number, but obviously its checksum doesn't match, so it is not a credit card or a debit card number. So it wouldn't even consider that kind of a number. So if you just go back to the number one of functional analysis, stage three, the example that you're looking at, it finds a matching checksum. However, we still don't stop over there. DLP goes ahead and performs another step, which is called additional evidence. So whenever you send a credit card number, there is always, you mention what type of credit card it is, a Visa, a MasterCard, American Express, Diners, or whatever. So you generally mention, you know, that this number is of this type. And accordingly, what you also check, or what DLP checks, is for any regular expression for the date format. So it tries to look for this additional evidence, you know, to be really sure or be 100% sure that this is a credit card number. Then based on all of this, it generates a verdict. So then it says, yes, I am 100% sure because I see a 16-digit number which also matches the checksum that I know of, which also has keywords like Visa within it, which also has a date that's close to it, which is there within the text. So I think it is 100% sure that this is a credit card number. So this is how DLP works. Okay, and this is that's why I said at the start, it does a lot of deep content analysis. So it's not just blindly looking for a 16-digit number. It's looking for all other things to prove that this is a credit card number and then take an appropriate action on it. If you take another example, you know, something very similar but a little bit different. So in this example at the very bottom that's just come up on the screen, I have sent a 16-digit number, and I've also put, you know, approximately I've put a validity date or an expiry date. But because, as you can, in the example that we mentioned, it is a 16-digit number, but it fails on step number three because there is no functional analysis, and it doesn't match the checksum. So this message, the second message at the bottom, would not be, it would be processed by DLP, but no action would be taken on it. Okay, so hopefully it's all clear now. So I'll bring up the demo and just show you. So I'll first switch to my other monitor so you can, so where am I? Okay, so this is, bring up my, so hopefully you can all see it. This is my Exchange Admin Center for Office 365. This is my, test tenant that I have in the cloud. And for those of you who have not seen it, this is how it looks like. It's a web-based console now. No more MMCs. The thing that we are interested in is DLP. DLP is a compliance feature. So we go ahead and click on compliance management. Within compliance management, we've got different categories. And the category that I'm interested in is data loss prevention. So I just click on data loss prevention. So I already have one over here because I was just doing some testing. So let's go ahead and create a new DLP policy. So when I click on this drop-down, I get three options. The first one is new DLP policy from template, and that template is your pre-canned templates, and we'll see what those are. The next one is import DLP policy. This one is if you work with a third-party vendor and they create this policy for you to go ahead and import it. So when you click on import, the DLP system recognizes this new classification and understands this new filtering that it needs to do. So that is what you would do in the second option. And the third option is if you really want to, create your own custom DLP policy without the use of a template, go ahead. You can go ahead and, create one for yourself. So what I'll do is I'll just create a new DLP policy from template. And here, where you can see choose a template, and you can see the whole list of templates that are available. And it's, as I said, it's broken down geographically. So you've got Australia, Canada, France, Germany, Israel, Japan, UK, the US. And within the US, if you see, you've got different ones, like you've got the Patriot Act, then you've got your anything for federal, then you've got your financial data. So you've got all these pre-canned templates, and if you want to look at the description, you can always read the description over here as to what the template, is going to do or what it's going to perform. So that is all that is available. So, I mean, it's so simple. I mean, in the sense that you choose your template, which is closest. So let us say you're in a country that doesn't have this template. Just look at the description, read about it, pick up the one that's closest, that's the closest match to what your business requirements are, and then you can tweak it. And when I say tweak it, I'll show you what I mean by how you can tweak it or you can adjust it. It's very, very flexible. So for this example, let us say I'll just pick up the one on the top, the Australian financial data. So I'll just call it Australian financial data. And I can give a description, anything that you want. And you see here, there's just a save button. There are no additional, prompts that you have to, that will ask you nothing. It's just going to read the template that I've selected. In my case, it's the Australian financial data, and it's just going to start off creating it. However, there is one more small, hidden option. It's called more options, but you can just click on that, and it tells you the type of mode you want to run this policy in. So, to give you an example, let us say you want to implement this policy. Always what we do is we go to a test environment, we go ahead and do our testing there, and then we come back into production and then implement in production. But if you think of DLP, where we are actually interested in the sensitive data, you cannot really replicate all that sensitive information in a test lab. You could, but it's not very easy. You cannot really simulate every end user's behavior in a test lab. But it is also scary to try and implement something directly into production because of the fear of breaking something. So while DLP was being created, these are the two options, three actually, but in broad sense there are two. One is the enforce and one is the test. So enforce means you've already done all your testing and you're fine with how DLP is running, you're fine with how DLP is processing all the sensitive data, and you're enforcing this policy. The test is you're The policy is running, it is evaluating, but it's not performing any action upon that. So it evaluates, it sees, okay, I found five credit card numbers, but it won't action upon it. It won't NDR the message, it won't do anything. However, it will create incident reports. And then you can actually go and look at these incident reports, see if there are lots of false positives, you know, kind of monitor it for a month and see how your DLP policies are working. Once you're satisfied that the DLP policies are working, then you can go ahead and change it to enforce. So in production, without affecting end users' productivity or without breaking anything, you can actually test everything and, you know, and kind of fine-tune it. And there is something over here called policy tips. So I'll come to what policy tips is, but just because we are over here talking about it. So policy tips are nothing but something equivalent to a mail tip. It is something notifying the end user, telling him or her that something has happened with regards to a policy. Okay, and I'll show it to you to be more clear. But this is just an end user prompt, something similar to a mail tip. Okay, so let me just leave it as such, and I'm just going to hit save. And once I hit save, it's now reading the template file and then generating all the type of rules, and then it should come up over here in a few few seconds. Just we'll wait for it to come up. There you go. So it comes up, and then you can see the mode it is in. So I can create, you know, any number of DLP policies that I want. And this is the one that I just created, test without policy tips. So it tells me which mode it is in. And this is the one that I've already created, and I've been using this for all the demos. So this is the one that I've already created. And if I click on one, and if I click on the rules, every DLP policy that you create will have five default rules created. So these are created automatically. Okay, so these are the five rules that are created when you create a DLP policy. If I show you the other one, the one that I created earlier, and if I click on the rules tab, even here you'll see five different rules. Okay, the five different rules. Very self-explanatory, but I'll bring up the ones that are very interesting, which is very special to DLP rule as such. So I'll open something called as the first one just called the low count. So let's just read it and see what exactly is the rule doing. Okay, so this rule would fire when the recipient is located outside the organization and it contains credit card numbers. And the action that is performed is notify the sender but allow them to send. Okay, so what you know, why are we actually allowing them to send? I said I see a credit card number, but why am I allowing them to, you know, send the email? So to look at the details, just go ahead and click on credit card number, and you can see values that are defined. So what I am saying is, what this particular rule is doing is, it is saying that in a particular email, if I see credit card numbers and I see up to 9 credit card numbers, I consider this as a low count, so I will allow it to go through. I can double click on it and I can actually configure it. So it is configurable. So it doesn't mean that you have to stick with 9. I can say no, my company doesn't allow 9 credit card numbers. I allow a maximum of 2. Okay, for 2 credit card numbers. So maximum 2, and I allow it through. If I see if the email has 3 credit card numbers, then I do some action on it. But for the low count, this is very easily configurable. You can uncheck it. You can go ahead and change it to any value that you want. It's absolutely flexible. This is what I kept saying from the start. It's very, very flexible. Okay. There is something additional over here. There is called the minimum confidence level and a maximum confidence level. This is the confidence level for the DLP rule. So what you're telling as an exchange admin is when you're telling, as an exchange admin, you're telling DLP that when you find a credit card number, you need to be 100% sure that this is a credit card number and only add it to the count. Okay? So if I have 2 credit card numbers, let's say the DLP looks at the first credit card number, it does all its analysis, it says, yes, I am 100% sure this is a credit card number, then DLP increases its count by 1 because it's marking, it's incrementing the value. Next day, it sees the second credit card number, it says, no, I'm 85% sure this is a credit card number, but because you as an admin have defined 100%, DLP rule will not increment it by 2, because it says that you as an admin have defined that DLP needs to be 100% sure that it's a credit card number, and only then I'll increment my count. So this is what is the low count. Similarly, we have something called as the high count. And the high count, I think you might have already guessed it. So the high count starts where the low count left off. And let's just read it. So this is recipients located outside the organization, contains credit card. And what we're going to do is, so this is the action part, you know, this two options, block the message, but allow the sender to override with a business justification. So if I click on that one, it is again very easily configurable. You can choose whatever you want. You can just say, I don't even want users to override this message. I just want to block the message. Okay, so here, this is the default. I didn't change it. So this is the default. The default is block the message. However, you can allow the end user to override it, but with a business justification so that you know you have an audit trail, because in the future, if there's a legal case, you can always say that it was the business justification says, you know, so and so, and that's the reason why this mail was approved to be, you know, to be sent out or whatever. And if you look back and go back to the credit card, and you can see here, so this is the high count. So credit card number is any number. So the minimum count is 10 and the maximum count is any. So again, as I said, yeah, configurable by the admin. You can change it, change the values, very flexible. You can tweak it the way you like it. Okay. And yep. So that is it. So that's all the admin had to do. Nothing fancy. And once you start, you know, working with this, okay, let me just show you one more thing where I said it kind of is a smart transport rule. If I just pull up the properties again, you can see here I've got add action. I've got add condition, you know, just like a transport rule. If you open up a transport rule, these are the exact same options you would get it. So I can add a condition if I want to. If I want, I can add an exception. Let us say I've got an in-house travel agent in my company, and I say I need an exemption for this particular user, so I can actually go ahead and select a particular user. You know, let's say it's this particular user. I can actually go ahead and set exemption. So as you can see, out of the box, it created what it thought was appropriate, but I can, as an admin, tweak it and fine-tune it to my business needs rather than just sticking with, you know, this act or a policy. Okay, so this is just a starting point, and because it's integrated into the transport rules, very flexible, change it the way you like. Okay, so I'll hit cancel, and a few more options that are available. I'll just talk to one about this is here. Just something to keep in mind is this option wherein these are the reports, you know, where it will kind of create a nice chart and tell you, and I've got a small snapshot. Mine is a demo environment, so I don't really have proper data to show it to you, but I have a small snapshot. These are nothing but it will create reports as to how many policies, you know, how many policies are running, of those, how many emails are being caught or how many emails are being blocked, how many false positives are being generated, etc., etc. And this is only available in Office 365. For any on-premise Exchange 2013 deployment, you won't have this button altogether. Okay, it's only available in Office 365. So just a small distinction for some of you who might be searching it, you know, if you have an on-prem test lab or on-prem production, you will not have this option. It's only available in Office 365. Okay, so anything else that I want to talk about? Okay, so as you saw, very straightforward, very easy, very flexible. That's all I had to do as an Exchange admin. Now I'll go ahead and continue with the rest of the slide deck and talk about the next part of it. Sorry, I need to change my mode. Okay. Okay, so hopefully you can all see it. And so what we just spoke about is the Exchange Transport Architecture. So that is the, you know, the first segment within the DLP's you know, structure. And the second what we're going to talk about right now is the Outlook Architecture. So you might be thinking, you know, if the server is doing everything, why would you need something on the client side? You know, I just showed you everything is there. It's going to catch credit card number. Everything is being done on the server side. Why is this additional Outlook architecture? You know, what was the premise? What was the criticality? What is the importance of introducing this Outlook architecture? Let me give you an example. So hopefully it's much clearer that way. Let us say you're a user and you're drafting an email. And your administrator has implemented this DLP policies. He's implemented it on the server. And that's fine. That's great. So you open this email and you're sitting and you're drafting. And let's assume that email does contain some sensitive information. Okay, you're genuinely writing an email with sensitive information in it, and you write this, you spend like 10, 15 minutes or even 20 minutes drafting this nice big email with all the data that's required, and you go and hit send. As soon as you hit send, it goes to the server looks at it, and then it says, sorry, I see a lot of sensitive data, and it sends you a DSN back or an NDR back. It would be a little bit disappointing. I say little, but I know how disappointing it can be for the end user, because he has spent all this time only to be notified that he is against policy or he is sending some data that is, you know, that contains sensitive information. How about going ahead and kind of notifying the user well ahead in advance within his Outlook client, telling him that I see, or, you know, kind of telling him that there is some sensitive data within that email. You know, it would be better if you kind of strip it off or use some other mechanism to send that sensitive data. Wouldn't that be great? And that is all the reason for developing an Outlook component for the DLP architecture. And the Outlook architecture, that is the client side, is exactly the same as the server architecture. So the three engines or the three agents that you have on the server side, you have the exact same engines on the client side. That is the text extraction, the policy evaluation, and the classification engine. So whatever happens, you know, whatever the end user is doing on his client, it would be looked at, and then appropriate actions will be taken. And just to show you what it would look like actually on the Outlook client, this is what it would look like. So when let's say an example in this screenshot, you can see a user has, you know, he's putting in some details and he's putting in some credit card numbers. Right then and there within the Outlook client, even before he has hit send, you get this prompt, and that is called the policy tip. It is similar to the mail tip, but its functionality is different, or its usage is different. So this is called a policy tip. The policy tip prompts the user that there seems to be some kind of sensitive data, and in this case, it's a credit card number. And this is, you know, customizable. So this is the default information. But if you're an admin, you want to be more specific and you want to write a little more, or the business says we need to specify, you know, we need to be more specific in the information that's given to the end user, you can happily customize it. And even if you look very closely in that small pop-up window that comes up, you have the Learn More section. If you actually click on it, you can actually redirect it to your internal policy if you want to. And the best selling point of this is this can even work when your Outlook client is disconnected, because the engine is running within the client. So this policy tip can even work when you are disconnected. So let us say I'm on train or on a flight, and I'm writing this email, and I've got, let's say, this credit card numbers. I've typed in a few credit card numbers. Because the engine is running within the client, this prompt would come up right away. Okay, so you don't have to be connected to the server to actually get this policy tip and be notified of any kind of issue. And I kept mentioning Outlook, you know, the client. And the client that you know, where you can see this policy tip is in Outlook 2013 only. And you have to be running Office 2013 Professional Plus Edition. And this is the only edition in which, you know, you would get a policy tip within Outlook. The second important thing to keep in mind is policy tips are not available in Outlook Web App. It may come in SP1, but don't hold me to it. It can come earlier, or it can come later, or you know, but don't hold me to that. You know, don't say say that, you know, I said that it's going to come in SP1. But this should not discourage you. That you know, oh, okay. So is it that if a user is using Outlook Web App, can I? The bypassing DLP, it is not bypassing DLP. You just won't get a policy tip. So let us say, okay, I open Outlook Web App, I draft an email, I won't get a policy tip at that moment. But when I hit send, that email is going to go to the Exchange server, it's going to get processed over there, where I have my DLP, you know, rules and policies, and then I would get a reply back from the server saying that I see some sensitive information within it. So it is not available in OWA means the policy tip is not available in OWA, in the OWA. It's the policy tips are only available in the Outlook 2013 client, not available in Outlook 2007, not available in Outlook 2010. I have no information if it's going to come out as a patch or anything. And this is inbuilt, okay? So you don't have to, or the admin doesn't have to again push out a plugin or push out an add-in or deploy something to the to all the clients such that Outlook can start understanding this. It's all inbuilt within the Outlook 2013 client. If you think of this, I spoke about two different architectures. One is the server side and one is the client side. So you might be thinking, okay, so you've got two different architectures, though they are similar. So is it that the Exchange admin has to manage two different things? Or, if I open up the admin console, is there a client section and is there a server section? No. The Exchange admin only has to manage the server side. What the Exchange server does is reads this DLP policy rules and creates an XML blob. And every time Outlook 2013 launches or fires open, it is going to request for this XML blob, which contains all the DLP policies, actions, whatever it needs to look for in sensitive data. So this XML data is pulled by Outlook every time it launches or once every 24 hours. That is if your Outlook is open for more than 24 hours. And it is actually controlled by this registry key. And if you just look at that, it's like a policy nudge. It's very self, it gives it away. So it's a policy nudge. So Outlook actually goes ahead and then, asks the server, do you have any new DLP templates that I should be aware of? If the Exchange server says yes, then Outlook is just going to pull that XML file down. Okay, and this is what helps the Outlook to work in an offline mode. Your policy tips are working. It is able to understand that you have put in, let's say, more than three credit card numbers. So it knows, yes, if it is more than three, I need to let the admin know, or sorry, let the end user know. So this is how it actually goes ahead. This is because of the XML file that the client downloads, which is Outlook 2013. Okay, so let's go to the last part of my demo and just show you how it looks on the client side. So here I've got a user called Alice, and this is connected to my Office 365. And I'm just going to launch a new email. And what I'll do is I'll just increase the text over here so that it's nice and easy to read. And I'm just going to send it to somebody external. And let's say this is a travel agency or something of that sort. And I'll say my reservations. And hello. I think I need to switch, sorry. Just one second. Come back to my primary. Okay, so this is what I was just doing. So what I did was, this is a user that I'm connected to called Alice. And Alice is, interested in making a reservation. So here's the details she's sending to a travel agent. And now she's just typing in her credit card details. And okay. So I have just finished drafting that email. And if you look closely, there is a policy tip that just comes up. So I'll just zoom in for those of you who might be on a smaller display. So here, right on top, you can see there's a policy tip, just above the send button, there's a policy tip. And if I hover my mouse over it, you should see some message come up. And this is what I was talking about, it's customizable. So you can see this is out of the box, you can customize this message. This is the policy tip. You can report, if you think that this doesn't contain sensitive information, you can actually report it to the admin. Or else, if you can click on Learn More, you can point it to an internal website which contains all your company policies. So what we have seen here is, I have put a credit card number, a 16-digit number, and I have put a word called Visa. Now just watch closely, and if I just delete the word Visa, the policy tip would disappear because it doesn't deem this to be a credit card number. Because it did a little bit of evidence gathering, and it found that it was just a 16-digit number without any additional evidence, so it deems this as a non-credit card number. And if I just go back and type in Visa again, hopefully it should just kick in a second or so, and you see the policy tip come back. So the engine is running within the Outlook client itself, and this is how it distinguishes, because as I said, it's got the same three engines that are running on the server. Okay. And just to prove that this works offline as well, I'm just going to try my luck here. And what I'm going to do is, I'm just going to just copy this once. I'm just being a little bit lazy. I'm just going to delete this mail. And what I'm going to do is set myself in work offline mode. And if you just look here, I'm in offline mode at the very moment. Okay, so I'm not connected to the Exchange server. I'll go ahead and create a new mail. And I'll just type in again, reservations, whatever, and my details. And I'm just going to paste that same thing again. And you can still see I'm in offline mode. And I'm just going to type in Visa. And hopefully, what I said to you is true. And we should see the policy tip come up. So you saw that. So it's an offline mode. I'm not connected to Exchange. So this is proving to you that the engine is running within the client. And if I just go back and just quickly delete the word Visa just for one last time, because my demo is being successful. There you go. So there you see. So it works even when in offline mode. Okay. So let me just go ahead and just bring myself back into online mode. So there I'm going, and I should connect in a second. While this is happening, let me just type in. Okay. Let me just leave that. What I'll do is I will now go ahead and I'm going to do group bookings. Okay, so I'm going to do a group booking, and I'm going to book for, let us say, 15 individuals. So I've got 15 credit card numbers, and instead of typing all of them, I've just written them down in a nice document, Word document, and I'm going to go ahead and send it. Okay, this group. Here they go. And as soon as I put that in, you see a different type of policy tip comes in, and I'm just going to zoom in for. And you can see over there the policy tip. You know, it's a little bit different. So it says, a few sentences. And then the important point to note over there is to send this message, you must override your organization policy. Okay. And you can see that I can still click on the send button. Okay. Let us say I don't care about that. I'm just going to hit send. You see what Outlook is going to do. It's going to actually prompt you, and it's not going to allow you to send that message, because as per the policy, I have set it to block. And I can only send this message if I set an override. Okay. So what I'll do is, okay, fine, you're not going to let me send it. I'm just going to do an override. So here I have two types of options over here. I have a business justification, and this message doesn't contain. So let me just take the default one. I have a business justification. This is for team outing and approved by, let's say, John Doe. Okay. So this is all going to be tracked, and I'll show you where exactly it's being tracked. Now I'm going to hit override, and you see now it just changes a bit, and now I can go ahead and hit send. Now I have hit send. What I have done is, let me just jump back to the policy, the one that I've created, and I have added an additional rule for the high count, where it states, I have added an additional one, this one, which I'm highlighting and which is a little bit in yellow. So I've said that generate an incident report and send it to reports mailbox, and it should contain everything. You know, I need all this information in the report. I can add more, but I was just interested in incident reports. And I'll go ahead and hit cancel, and I'll jump back to the reports mailbox. So where is my reports mailbox? There you go. So in the reports mailbox, you see a new mail has come in, group booking, the name that I've given to that email. I'll click on it. And this is the actual email that I had sent. However, there's a lot of information, additional information within the body of this email. So the first thing that we can look is any overrides. So override, there is a yes, and the justification is the justification that I typed in. Okay, so there is an audit trail. You know, in the event, if there is ever a legal situation, you can always say yes, I received a justification, and this is what was mentioned. You can also see what was the data classification. So it found credit cards. Out of those 15, dummy credit cards that I gave, it found 12 of them, 12 valid credit card numbers. It tells you also which rule it was. So it tells me it was the PCI DSS rule. And it tells me which particular one within that rule. So it is the high count rule that actually, encountered it, and then it performed this particular action. So this is your audit report mailbox. So you can, as I said, this was something that I added. So I, as an admin, would perform this action, and then this is how I kind of look into all this data, and then I can use it for, safekeeping purposes, or I can use this for my fine-tuning purposes. If there are lots of false positives, here is, like, you can see the false positive. This was not a false positive because it was, DLP was short that it is a credit card number. Okay. Okay, so we've seen all this in in Outlook, and we saw Outlook, we saw the policy tip. That's great. What about a user who is using OWA, or he's using Outlook 2007 or Outlook 2010? So this is a user, Mr. Bob Dango, and he is a branch, he's the manager of a branch site. So in your branch offices, let's say you have not deployed any SAT clients and you've just given them access to OWA. But he needs to book a team outing for his 15 members that he has in his team. So let's go ahead and click on new mail, and let us go to the same reservations email. And in the subject, I'll type in so I'm just calling this hello. Okay, so these are the details, and that's it. So I'm just going to send, and I'm going to attach that particular document that that contained all the bogus or dummy credit card numbers. So I'm just going to hit open. So once it is attached, you see there is no prompt, no policy tip. As I mentioned, it's expected. However, now I'm just going to go and hit send, and as soon as I hit send, it goes to the server. The server then is going to read through that, and it's going to find some, message within it, and you see the reply back. It comes back, and it says, deliver was failed to these recipients or groups. Unable to deliver your message, you can override this policy by adding the word override to the subject line. So where is this exactly coming from, this particular statement? It, again, is coming from your DLP rule. So if I just go back, and if I'll open up the high count one, because I know that's where it is, because I've sent like more than 15 credit card numbers. I'll go back over there, and I'll open up this one. Notify the sender. So I'll just click on this. So the second message, the second box that you can see there, this message is sent to all clients that are not using Outlook 2013. So all clients that cannot show a policy tip, this message would be sent back to them in their DSN or in their NDR. Okay, so this is where is that message coming from. So that's the word, and I can change this. It's customizable. I can say use the word instead of override. I can say something else. Okay, let me go through or whatever you want. So it's all customizable. Okay, so let me go back. Let me go back to my Mr. Bob. He's trying to do a team outing, so I'll help him with that. So I'll go back to reply all, and I'm just being a little bit lazy. And okay, so I'll just remove the word. And as per the message, it said, go ahead and use the word override. So I'm just going to use override, and it's not case sensitive, so I'm just using a word override. So it can be anything. You can put a hyphen after that. You can, you cannot put a colon or whatnot. It's up to you. It's just going to look for the word override within the subject line. I'm going to go and hit insert. Sorry, and I'm just going to add the group hotel bookings again. So again, I'm just going to hit send, and this time I'll come back to the inbox, and I'll just wait for 1 or 2 seconds just to prove that there's no NDR coming back. So it shouldn't, it would not come. I know that for a fact. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the reports mailbox, okay? And in the reports mailbox, you can see two new emails coming through. The first one was during the first one. When I sent it for the first time and I got it rejected. So this is like because it's my reports mailbox and I'm kind of capturing each and everything. So here you can see the message called override. There is no override. And then you can see all the details and you can see which one hit it, et cetera, et cetera. If I go to the second one where I typed in the word override, you can actually go ahead and see the, the value within the, what the DLP rule looks at. And you can see that's an override as an yes. So this is the, this is how you can actually go ahead and create this kind of a reports mailbox, capture all of this. And this can also be used for your fine tuning purposes. So you can actually set up this policy and, without enforcing it. And you can have users send and receive email. And then you can come to this incident mailbox and you can actually go ahead and look at it. And if you're Office 365, as I told you, you have this nice reporting section, which I'll just show you in a slide or two as to how it works. So these are all the functions of DLP, and this is how the client behaves. So I showed you how Outlook client behaves, and if you're not using Outlook, you can still use Outlook Web App. You won't get a policy tip, but it would you know, the DLP policies will still kick in. You're not bypassing DLP, okay? The DLP will kind of shout back and say, I see sensitive data. Let me now jump back again to my secondary screen. Missed this. Just putting it all into perspective, is this is the whole system. You know, so on the left you have the admin, in the center you have the Exchange server, and at the bottom you have your, you know, laptop or desktop. That's the end user. So the admin creates a DLP policy that's obviously, you know, created on the Exchange server. And at the bottom of the Exchange server, you see the small notepad kind of an icon. That's the XML blob that Exchange generates. And this is the XML blob that Outlook pulls, that is Outlook 2013 pulls, which contains all the updated DLP policies and templates and what actions it needs to take place. So if a user or an information worker is using Outlook 2013, he gets a contextual policy education, which is nothing but a policy tip. However, if that user is using, you know, the earlier versions of Outlook, or he's using Outlook web app, he sends the message, but on the back end, you know, the evaluation is taking place, because we said we've, you know, there is DLP running on the server and it's also running on the client as such. So the rules kick in, and then it's going to, you know, scan or look at the content of the email, and then appropriate action is taken. So you can create your audit and your incident data generation. And with regards to reports that I kept saying about, and this is what it looks like in short. And this is only available in Office 365, again reiterating the fact. And once you launch those reports, you can see at the very bottom of that screenshot, you can see the three policies that are created. And within the three policies, you can see the detection rate that's happening. You can see the number of overrides that are happening, and you can see the number of false positives that are being generated. So depending on that, then you can tweak, you know, if our users just unnecessarily creating overrides, or you need to set the overrides more stricter, or if the detections are not happening properly, you know, depending on all these data, you can actually go ahead and fine tune your DLP policy. And then accordingly, you know, either, you know, tune it, or you can detune it, or, you know, make it more sensitive, you know, make it less sensitive, depending, you know, according to what your business needs are. Okay, so this is what is the report as such. And in closing and in summary, I know I've overrun a bit, sorry. So what does DLP features provide you with? It provides the end user, when you're using Outlook, a policy tip, in advance, even before the user sends that email out. This is available both on the Exchange on-prem and it's available both in Office 365. DLP templates are available out of the box. However, if your organization needs some custom templates, you can go ahead and work with a third-party vendor, or you can go on MSDN, and there are lots of resources if you want to create your own. Feel free to do it. The DLP administration is only one point of control. That is, you just use the Exchange Admin Center to do everything. And it's got rich reporting capabilities. Through the incident mailbox that I showed you, and the reports are very comprehensive. Or else you can use the reporting within the Exchange Admin Center, the snapshot that I just showed you earlier. If you don't want to go and sift through lots of email, you can just go ahead and just use the reporting section feature to go ahead and fine tune your DLP policies. So that's all I had to talk to you about DLP. Hope I was able to talk to you about everything and show you the power and the richness of the DLP feature set. And we are now open for questions.
Great. Thank you so much, Roop. That was a fantastic session. So let's